Greetings Earthlings, another quick inbox review for you here. This is of a new kit from Dragon under their Black Label Boutique range, and it's the British Armoured Car Saladin Mark II. So the Saladin was an armoured car, obviously, that was designed just after World War II by the Alvis Company of Coventry in England, and it was part of what was known as the FV600 family of vehicles, and there were four vehicles in the family, all of which were based around a common design of chassis, this 6x6 chassis. So there was the Saladin, which is an armoured car designed for sort of reconnaissance duties. There was the Saracen, which was a wheeled armoured personnel carrier. There was the Stalwart, which was an amphibious truck. And there was the Salamander, which was an airport crash tender. So these were all actually designed by Alvis as kind of a private venture, and they managed to sell them then onto the British Army. Well, they did manage to sell the Saladin, Saracen and the Stalwart. These things came into service in, I think, the mid-1950s, and served through the 1960s and into the early 70s, where the Saladins eventually were replaced by the Scorpion tank. So this is quite a familiar vehicle for a lot of British armour modellers. It's the type of thing that they've probably seen around, especially if they're the same age as me, if they're in their sort of mid-40s, this will be a familiar vehicle. Now this is not the first time that this has been done in 35th scale. Tamiya came out with one which was pretty dreadful. Basically it was a plastic box with a turret on it. It was designed to be motorised and basically had to fit all the motorisation gear, so the box was made big enough to fit the motorisation gear, and it really looked very little like a Saladin. The turret from that kit was salvaged though, and if you've ever seen the M113 fire support vehicle that Tamiya make, then that's the turret that they use. But anyway, this is a completely new kit from Dragon, and well, it's nice to see some sort of Cold War British armour for a change. We see lots of Soviet vehicles and the occasional American vehicle. It would be nice to see something from the Brits. Before I go in, there's something very interesting I think about this box. I'll say very interesting, something that struck me at any rate, which was, you notice this pattern here, and you notice the trees here, and also there's a similar sort of pattern here. Obviously this artwork is good old Ron Volstad, so it's always nice to see Mr. Volstad's work. But obviously the artwork wasn't quite big enough to fit the space in the box, so they've had to extend it a bit. This looks like good old typical Photoshop work with the clone brush. Anyway, there we go. That's very boring. What's inside? Well, you know those Dragon kits you get where after you've opened the box and looked at the bits, you can't fit them back in the box and get the lid on? Well, this is the other kind. There is quite a lot of empty space in the box, to be honest. Having said that, some nice looking parts. Let's start with the lower hull. Here's the lower hull. And you can see it's very nicely detailed, really. It's got the flanges there that held the thing together. Some nice details for the suspension. Not very much on the bottom, but nice detail there for, I think that's an escape hatch, and a bit at the back. So very nice crisp detail. This looks like a much more likely shape for the Saracen's lower hull than that bland box that was in the old Tamiya kit. You also get in this bag a small clear sprue with some headlamp lenses, and I think that's the driver's sort of episcope port. Then there's the top of the hull, showing the quite nice sort of sloped shape of the top of the Saracen hull. The engine deck there with the cooling vents, So again, quite nice. And the turret. This is the top of the turret. Very nice single part moulding there with holes there for the grab handles. And the space in the front there for the gun mantlet. So that all looks very nice indeed. Tyres. Now these are made of Dragon's DS100 sort of, well, it's supposed to be a styrene, it's sort of a flexible styrene. They're very nice. There's no mould seam on the tyres, which is always very good to see. And the way they're designed is that they are hollow on one side, and when you come to actually build them, you'll fit the inside of the tyre to that, and hopefully that'll be on the inside where you won't see the join. And since this is supposed to be gluable with ordinary plastic cement, you should be able to glue the two together. I've tried this before on other Dragon vehicles, and I tend to find that the insert that goes into here tends to be a little bit too deep, so it generally needs to be sanded down. But other than that, it works pretty well actually. It's hard to fill the gap because they don't fit exactly. It's quite hard to fill the gap because this is flexible, and if you move it at all while the filler's in there, the filler just breaks out. But certainly easier to work with than a lot of rubber tyres. And then the sprues. We've got some wheels. These are there's actually sort of two and a half identical sprues here. There's three of these bits, but two of them are attached to more bits that contain stowage bins and suspension details. And then there's sort of a main sprue, if you like, with the mudguards, fenders if you're on the other side of the Atlantic, and the turret base, the glacis, the gun mantlet, some suspension details. These are springs. And the hatches. The hatches bizarrely have no detail on the inside. So although they're actually movable, they're workable, there's no detail on the inside. There's no detail on the inside of the vehicle at all. So if you want to have the hatches open, you'll need probably to put some figures in them, but also to detail the inside of the hatches. So probably not too difficult, just needs a head pad and some latches and stuff. One thing that did surprise me was the jerry cans. Take a look at this jerry can. Now this is quite the worst jerry can I have seen in a vehicle kit probably since about 1970. That really is absolutely abysmal. The proportions are all wrong. It should be a lot deeper. The pattern here is offset to the left. The handle doesn't fit. This is the other half of it here. It's just it's really poor. I mean, luckily jerry cans are easy to replace, but I mean, damn, that's terrible. The happier things. There's the nice coax machine gun, and you can see it's got a hollow point because, as Chris pointed out the other day, we have to have hollow points in our tank kits because we're just not good enough to put them in ourselves. So thanks, Chris, for pointing that out. I appreciate that, pal. Okay, there's all the bits. What about the instructions? Well, fairly straightforward Dragon instructions. They're in this kind of roll fold format, and as you can probably tell from the number of parts, there aren't all that many steps to the instructions. There's really not that much to the kit. I'll very quickly go through them. You just fit out the engine deck, fit out the suspension, and then put the top on, put the wheels on, and those, that's the construction of the wheels. You can see these are the rubber tires and these are the plastic inserts, and then the rest of it is just basically very simple assembly, gluing small bits onto big bits. Those are the hatches and they can be made workable. And finally you end up with fitting the turret on, and there you go. So not a very involved build, which actually I quite like the sound of, that sounds very good. There are 6 markings options supplied, one for the 1st Royal Tank Regiment Cyprus 1975, that's kind of in their peacekeeping mission there. Another one that just says British Army, which could be anywhere at pretty much any time during the operational lifetime of the vehicle. And then one of the Queen's Royal Irish Hussars in Brunei in 1963. One of A Squadron, the Queen's Own Hussars in 1966. One of B Squadron, 3rd RTR in Sharjah, Persian Gulf, 1968. And another one for Sharjah, 1968, also from the same outfit. So all of those really coming from pretty much the same time period, apart from probably the first one there, which is a little bit later in the mid 1970s. That I think would have been coming very much up to the last days of the use of this vehicle. I think that's probably the one I will do. It just seems the most interesting one. But these were used for a long time, and in many places, so you've probably got quite a few options there. The only other things to look at are the decal sheets, which has quite a lot on it really. It's quite with 6 options, it's got quite a lot to do there. Now I'm not very good with the British Arm of Service markings, so I can't tell you if those are correct or not, but there's a lot to be getting on with there. So it's nice to have so many options, that's good. And finally, a single piece of etched brass that fits over the back. Now I don't think this is intended to be pre-bent, I think it just got bent in the box. And that's it, that's your etched brass. But this is a smart kit. Smart kit is Dragon's way of saying don't expect too much. And neither should we. We also shouldn't expect too much because it's a black label kit, and the black label range hasn't really blown many people away with its accuracy. There's been several kits in that range now, and none of them has exactly been wonderful. This, I think, doesn't look too bad. I don't have too many references of the Saladin, but this seems to match with those that I have. So far I'm cautiously optimistic about it being fairly accurate. So there we go, that's the Saladin. I've been looking forward to this kit, I have to say, and I'm not really disappointed by it. I think it's going to be a very quick and simple build, and I'll probably just build it straight out of the box, and it's nice to have a Saladin in the display. Coming soon from the Black Label range also is a Conqueror Mark II tank, a British post-war heavy tank that had the same gun as the American M103 heavy tank. Hopefully they will not be using the gun from the Black Label M103 kits because it's the wrong length. Mind you, almost everything in those kits is wrong. I think the wheels are about the right size, and that's pretty much everything that's correct in those M103 kits. Anyway, that's all for this kit. I hope you enjoyed the review. I hope this is of interest to you. If you have any comments, please post them. And I will be back again very soon with more reviews and updates. In the meantime, happy modelling and goodbye.